JFT, just fair and direct.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to JFD's daily market review for May the 21st. I am Charalambos Pissouros, senior market analyst here at JFD, and I will talk about yesterday's main market movers, what's my opinion moving ahead, what are today's important events, and how they could affect the markets. But before we start, let's read our disclaimer. The content we produce does not constitute investment advice or investment recommendation, should not be considered as such, and does not in any way constitute an invitation to acquire any financial instrument or product. I will leave you a few seconds to read the rest, and then we will jump into our analysis. Okay, the dollar continued trading lower against the majority of the G10 currencies on Wednesday and during the Asian morning Thursday. It underperformed the most against SEK, CHF and New Zealand dollar in that order, while it gained only versus the pound and slightly against the Canadian dollar. The weakening of the dollar and the strengthening of the risk-linked kiwi suggests that risk appetite rebounded again at some point. However, the fact that the Swiss franc was among the top performers points otherwise. Thus, given the blurry picture painted by the FX performance, we prefer to turn our gaze to the equity world in order to clear things up. Here, major EU and US indices were a sea of green, as you can see on the graph here, with investors forgetting the reports that cast doubts over a coronavirus vaccine. It seems that they prefer to increase their bets on a recovery in global economic growth as major economies continue to loosen their restrictive measures. An upbeat start for Wall Street due to new records by Facebook and Amazon may have also helped the broader sentiment. That said, risk appetite softened during the Asian session today, with Japan's Nikkei 225 and China's Shanghai Composite sliding 0.12 and 0.15% respectively. Maybe this was due to headlines suggesting more tensions between the US and China. Yesterday, US senators decided unanimously to pass a bill which makes it hard for Chinese firms to stay listed in the US, while overnight, US President Trump accused China over disinformation in order to hurt his re-election chances. As for our view, it has not changed. Remember that yesterday we noted that we would treat Tuesday's retreat in equities as a corrective move, and yesterday's recovery adds some credence to that view. We repeat that with headlines suggesting that more fiscal and monetary stimulus around the globe is underway, and with the virus curve being much flatter than a couple of months ago, investors may keep increasing their risk exposures as they divert flows out of safe havens. One of the risks to that view is further escalation in the tensions between the US and China, which may revive fears that the world's two largest economies are unlikely to secure a final trade deal and even jeopardize the already agreed Phase 1 accord. Now back to the currencies. The pound was the main loser among the G10s. This may have been due to the miss in the UK CPIs for April, but also due to fresh comments around negative interest rates in the UK. Following the disappointing inflation data, Bank of England Governor Andrew Bailey noted that he and his colleagues do not rule out anything for policy and that negative interest rates are under active review. His comments come after Bank of England's chief economist Andy Haldane said on Friday that the bank is looking more urgently at negative interest rates, increasing the chances for the committee to proceed with such an action in the months to come. At their latest meeting, Bank of England officials kept their policy unchanged but noted that the current QE is set to reach its target at the beginning of July. This, combined with their readiness to take further action if needed, suggests that a QE expansion may be on the cards at the June meeting. That said, the big question now is whether such a decision will be accompanied by negative interest rates or whether they will decide to wait for a while before they proceed with cutting rates. In our view, the prospect of further easing by the Bank of England, combined with the risk of a no-deal Brexit by the end of the year, may keep the currency under selling interest for a while more. Conditional upon further recovery in risk appetite, we would prefer to exploit any pound losses against currencies that tend to benefit during periods of market optimism, like the risk-linked Aussie and Kiwi. Now, as for today's events, during the European morning, we get the preliminary PMIs for May from several Eurozone members and the bloc as a whole. Both Eurozone's manufacturing and services indices are expected to have rebounded to 38 and 25 after hitting record lows at 33.4 and 12 respectively. This will drive the composite PMI up to 25 from 13.6. Although this data would point to an improvement, all readings would still be well below the boom or bust barrier of 50, and thus they are unlikely to provide a massive boost to the euro. When they last met, ECB policymakers eased the conditions of the TLTROs and introduced a new series of non-targeted pandemic emergency long-term refinancing operations called PELTROs, staying ready to adjust all of their instruments as appropriate to ensure that inflation moves towards their aim in a sustainable manner. With that in mind, we believe that the PMIs could keep the door for further stimulus wide open. We get the preliminary PMIs for May from the UK and the US as well. No forecast is available for the UK numbers, while in the US both the manufacturing and services indices are expected to have rebounded to 38 and 30 from 36.1 and 26.7 respectively. The US existing home sales for April and the initial jobless claims for last week are also coming out. Existing home sales are expected to have tumbled 18.9% month over month after declining 8.5% in March, while jobless claims are forecast to have surged by another 2.4 million. As for tonight, during the Asian Morning Friday, we have New Zealand's retail sales for the first quarter and Japan's national CPIs for April. No forecast is available for New Zealand's data, neither for Japan's headline CPI. The core CPI rate is expected to have slid to minus 0.1% year-over-year from plus 0.4%. We also have three Fed speakers on today's agenda: Chair Jerome Powell, Vice Chair Richard Clarida, and Board Governor Lyle Brainard. So that's it from me. Thank you very much for watching and listening. For those who are interested on learning more about the main events of the week much earlier, you can subscribe to the weekly Market Outlook webinar, which I'm holding every Monday at 7 o'clock AM GMT time. You can find the link in the description below. So goodbye, have a great day, and I'm looking forward to seeing you here again tomorrow.
JFT, just fair and direct.